Loving in her room. Got a contract with the Lord. Way up yonder.
Where is Garabandal and what is it? Garabandal is an isolated village with a population of about 300 people in the Cantabrian mountains of northwestern Spain. The village is imbued with supernatural serenity and beauty. On June 18, 1961, four girls, Conchita Gonzales, Jacinta González, and Marie Loli Mazón, who were 12 years old at the time, and Marie Cruz González, who was 11, were playing together in the village when they heard a sound like thunder. They were frightened and raised their heads to see where the noise came from. Suddenly, they saw before them the beautiful, resplendent figure of an angel. After a few brief moments and without a word, he disappeared. During the next few days, the angel continued his visits, during which he looked at them in silence and smiled. The people of Garabandal began to meet with the girls in the evening to pray the rosary while they waited for the angel to appear. Finally, on June 1st, 1961, the angel spoke to the girls and said, "Do you know why I have come? I have come to proclaim that the Blessed Virgin Mary will appear to you tomorrow as Our Lady of Mount Carmel." The girls, filled with joy, cried out simultaneously, "Tell her to come soon." On June 2nd, in those days, the feast day of the Visitation, at around 6 p.m., the girls were in the calleja, a stone path, when the Blessed Virgin appeared to them with the child Jesus and two angels. The girls recognized one of them as the angel who had appeared to them previously, who was later identified as Saint Michael the Archangel. The other was almost completely identical. Above the Blessed Virgin, to the right, there was an eye which the girls called the Eye of God. Without fear, the girls began to speak with the Blessed Virgin. They told her about their families and the work they did in their houses or in the fields, and the Blessed Virgin Mary smiled at them. Conchita said that it was as if her own mother had been gone on a long trip and had just come home. They prayed the rosary with the Blessed Virgin, who taught them to pray the rosary well. When the Blessed Virgin said she had to leave, the little girls pleaded with her to stay. To console them, she promised that she would return the following day. She did return, not only on the following day, but on hundreds of occasions, sometimes appearing several times during the day or the night. The girls knew when Our Lady was going to appear to them, thanks to what the girls themselves called the llamadas, or interior calls. They received three interior calls, in which they experienced an increasing joy that preceded and announced the apparition. After the third interior call, the joy was so intense that they began to run from wherever they were towards the place of the apparition. They arrived almost simultaneously and fell onto their knees abruptly in an ecstatic trance. In August of 1961, the girls began to walk during their ecstasies. With their eyes fixed upwards, they walked forwards and backwards throughout the village. During the first apparitions, the girls offered pebbles to the child Jesus, whom the Blessed Virgin sometimes brought with her, because they wanted to make him laugh. The child did not take the pebbles, but our mother did. She kissed them and requested that they be given to certain people after the ecstasy. The onlookers soon began to give the girls numerous religious objects for Our Lady to kiss. Or when the girls were not present, They left the objects on tables next to the girls' houses, which were placed there for that very purpose. There was no way for the girls to know to whom each article belonged. Even so, during the ecstasies, with their faces always turned upwards and with their eyes fixed on heaven, guided by the vision, in all of the thousands of times that they returned rosaries, medals, wedding rings and other religious objects to their owners, they never made a mistake. On a certain occasion, the girls were surprised to find a powder compact among the objects to be kissed by the Blessed Virgin. They doubted whether to present to her a seemingly secular object. But when the Blessed Virgin arrived, the first thing she asked to kiss was that compact, saying that it belonged to her son. When the ecstasy ended, the owner of the compact revealed that during the Spanish Civil War, the compact had been used to take the Eucharist to prisoners and to those who were about to be executed. During the ecstasies, our little protagonists always brought a crucifix which they offered to the onlookers to venerate. They normally held out the crucifix to whomever the Blessed Virgin indicated to the girls. After an ecstasy, Conchita found out that those who had kissed the crucifix, though they weren't dressed as priests, were in reality priests. During the ecstasies, the girls recognized priests and religious on numerous occasions, though they were dressed normally, with no way for the girls to distinguish them other than through the visions. Little by little, as the news was spread by word of mouth, visitors began to arrive from outside of the village, some from outside of Spain. 500 to 3,000 people arrived each day and joined the villagers of Garabandal in prayer as they waited for the apparition. Soon many priests and doctors approached the girls during the ecstasies with the intention of judging whether the apparitions were genuine. Some of the first to arrive in the little mountain village were prestigious theologians, teachers, diocesan priests and religious, some of whom held important positions in the church. They carried out their theological and doctrinal investigations and examined the girls' lives. They concluded that the girls were perfectly healthy and well-balanced. They did not crave attention, though at the same time, they had not completely overcome their childish ways, which emphasizes the fact that they were completely normal. They verified that in the months of the apparition, the girls did not neglect their educational obligations, housework, chores, or labor in the fields. Though during the apparitions, the girls sometimes stayed in vigil until early in the morning, suffering the harsh weather, rain, cold, and snow. The Blessed Virgin often repeated to them that they should be obedient to their parents. She also encouraged them to make sacrifices, especially for the holiness of priests, and so that those priests who waver might persevere. She taught them to detest sin and helped them to form their consciences by responding to the thousands of questions the girls asked her. The girls affirmed that after seeing the Blessed Virgin Mary, they yearned to love Jesus and Mary more, and to tell everyone about the Lord and His Most Blessed Mother. The simple and trusting relationship that the little girls had with their Heavenly Mother was truly exceptional. In certain occasions, she played with the girls, and she often said goodbye to them with a kiss. The doctors were astonished to see the strange physical phenomena that accompanied the ecstasies, during which they had absolutely no sensitivity to pain, even when people poked them with needles or burned them with cigarettes. Their bodies acquired extraordinary weight, which made it impossible to pick them up or even to force them to make the slightest movement. While they contemplated the apparition, their eyes were completely open as they contemplated the apparition. Yet when cameras flashed, or onlookers shined powerful lights into their eyes, their expressions did not change. They ran towards the site of the apparition and got there before everyone else, including the strong and healthy young boys. And while the rest of the people arrived sweating and out of breath, the girls arrived without any signs of physical fatigue. They fell hard onto their knees on the stones without hurting themselves. They walked forwards and backwards during the ecstasies on the poorly paved streets of the village, or even cross-country, with their heads completely raised and their eyes constantly fixed upwards. Though they were totally unable to see where they were going, they never fell or tripped. None of this has a natural explanation. Amongst the many priests who went to Garabandal to study the events was Father Luis Maria Andreu, a Jesuit. He and his brother, also a Jesuit, Father Ramon Andreu, moved more out of curiosity than out of a hope to find something serious, visited Garabandal. They were convinced by what they saw that the girls were telling the truth. On August 8th, 1961, Father Luis Maria Andreu made a second visit to Garabandal. That night, when the girls fell into ecstasy, he approached them to observe them closely. Suddenly, those who were with him saw that an indescribable enthusiasm invaded the priest. His face changed and tears began to fall down his cheeks. He suddenly cried out, "Miracle! Miracle! Miracle! Miracle!" In the car, as he returned to his residence that same night, his companions were impressed by the joy that overwhelmed him and by his complete surety as he spoke of the events of Garabandal. He repeated enthusiastically, "I'm so happy. The Blessed Virgin has given me an immense gift. We're so lucky to have a mother like her in heaven. There's no doubt in my mind that the visions are true. Today is the happiest day of my life." After that last phrase, there was silence. "Father, what's wrong?" Father Luis Maria Andreu had died. He was still a young man and had no known illness. The Blessed Virgin Mary told the girls that on August 8th, Father Luis Maria Andreu had not only seen her, but he had also seen the great miracle that would come. What did the Blessed Virgin mean when she said, "great miracle"? In October of 1961, the Blessed Virgin Mary revealed to Conchita the great miracle. Later, she also told the other three. Conchita says that it will be a Thursday at 8:30 p.m. and will last 15 minutes, but a visible sign will remain in the pines until the end of times. It will coincide with the great event in the church. The sick who are in Garabandal will be cured. The sinners will convert and the unbelievers will believe. Conchita will announce the date of the miracle 8 days in advance. In order to prepare us for the great miracle, a supernatural warning coming directly from God will occur. The warning will appear in the sky and will be visible to the whole world. It will be understood by everyone at the same time, regardless of their state of life or knowledge of God. It will be a terrible experience, but it will be for the well-being of the souls, because we will see interiorly, in our conscience, the good and the evil we have done. God desires our salvation. The purpose of the warning is not to cause us to fear, but to bring us closer to Him and to increase our faith. If the world does not change after the miracle, a chastisement will come. Conchita says, "If we do not change, the chastisement will be horrible. Loli, Jacinta, and I have seen it, but I cannot say what it consists of, because I do not have Our Lady's permission." October 18th, 1961 was a day of great importance in the history of the apparitions of Our Lady of Garabandal. It was the day that the Blessed Virgin Mary gave the girls permission to announce the first message. The heavy rain that did not cease during the entire day did not discourage the thousands of people who arrived in Garabandal that day. As the evening fell, the girls read the text of the message in the pine trees. "We must make many sacrifices, perform much penance, and visit the Blessed Sacrament frequently. But first, we must lead good lives. If we do not, a chastisement will befall us. The cup is already filling up, and if we do not change, a very great chastisement will come upon us." With the simplicity of a mother, Our Lady gave her children the advice that they needed to hear, for the good of their own souls. If we don't choose the way of the cross, if the Eucharist is not the center of our lives each day, if we are not good, if we do not convert, the Lord will have no choice but to intervene to make us understand the importance of what is at stake, our salvation. After the girls had proclaimed the first message, they often asked the Blessed Virgin to perform a miracle that would help the people to believe in the apparitions. When there was not Mass in the town, St. Michael the Archangel would bring the Eucharist to the girls so that they would not miss communion. One day, St. Michael told Conchita that on a certain occasion he would bring her communion, and the host would become visible on her tongue. Conchita did not think it was a very impressive miracle, because she thought that the host was always visible to those who were present. Conchita announced the date of the miracle 15 days in advance. When the awaited day arrived, there were hundreds of people in the village. The miracle took place on July 19, 1962 at 1:30 a.m. One of the main concerns of the Blessed Virgin in Garabandal was to help us to grow in our love and veneration of the Eucharist. In that sense, it is fitting that the miracle was precisely a Eucharistic miracle. One of the witnesses was able to record on video the brief seconds in which the white host appeared in Conchita's mouth. During the first 2 years, the heavenly manifestations constantly increased in number. But starting in 1963, the girls had fewer apparitions. And sometimes Our Lady, or occasionally Our Lord Himself, chose to speak to them through interior locutions. Despite all of this, pilgrims continued to come to Garabandal in great numbers, and many of the pilgrimages came from outside of Spain. The little village in the mountains received visits from important church figures, reporters from important news agencies, diplomats, entrepreneurs, writers, etc. Notable conversions and healings, both of a physical and spiritual nature, took place in Garabandal. Our Lady of Garabandal is specialized in healing hearts and souls. The second message of the Blessed Virgin Mary came on June 18, 1965. Only a few months before the end of the apparitions. St. Michael was sent by the Blessed Virgin to impart the message to Conchita. As St. Michael spoke, tears began to stream down Conchita's face. As my message of October 18th has not been fulfilled and has not been made known to the world, I tell you that this is my last message. Before, the cup was filling up. Now it is overflowing. Many cardinals, many bishops, and many priests are on the road to perdition and are taking many souls with them. Less and less importance is being given to the Eucharist. You should turn the wrath of God away from yourselves by your efforts. If you ask for His forgiveness with sincere hearts, He will forgive you. I, your mother, through the intercession of St. Michael the Archangel, ask you to amend your lives. You are now receiving the last warnings. I love you very much and do not want your condemnation. Pray to us with sincerity and we will grant your requests. You should make more sacrifices. Meditate on the Passion of Jesus. The message, though brief, is rich in content and describes the painful situation that the Catholic Church was living at that time, as the Second Vatican Council was about to come to a close. Several months after this message was proclaimed, Pope Paul VI published the encyclical Mysterium Fidei, in which he expresses his grave concern for the doctrinal confusion regarding the greatest treasure that the Church possesses, the Eucharist. However, on June 18, 1965, Conchita could not have known about this, because the doctrinal and liturgical crisis that had begun in the heart of the church had barely reached Spain, and certainly had not reached this village lost in the mountains. Either way, the great crisis which occurred among the priests was unthinkable. Soon, however, it became reason for a new and profound affliction for the successor of Peter and for the entire church. November 13, 1965, was a bittersweet day for Conchita. She walked alone to the pines as the rain fell down on her. The Blessed Virgin Mary appeared again to the young woman. She came with the child Jesus, who was all smiles, but this would be the last time. Addressing Conchita, the Blessed Virgin Mary said, "Conchita, tell me about my children. I have all of them under my mantle. I love you all very much and I desire your salvation. Give all you can and we will help you. This will be the last time you see me here. But I will be with you always and with all my children. Conchita, you should visit my son more often in the tabernacle. Why do you let yourself be led by your laziness to not visit him? He is waiting for you all, day and night." Conchita responded to the Blessed Virgin, "How happy I am when I see you. Why don't you take me with you right now?" She answered, "Remember what I told you on your saint's day. When you present yourself before God, you must show him your hands filled with the good works you have done for your brothers and for the glory of God. In this moment, your hands are empty." Those words marked the end of the visible manifestation of Our Lady in Garabandal. The happy moments the girls had spent with their Heavenly Mother had come to an end, but they continued to feel her presence and the impression she had made on their souls. Conchita said that the apparitions left my soul full of peace and joy and gave me a great desire to overcome my defects and to love the Lord and His Most Holy Mother with all my strength. Our Heavenly Mother wants to leave that same impression on all of our souls. The certainty that we have a mother who is close to us and who looks after us. The desire of conversion that is born in our souls through meditating on the Passion, love and veneration for the Eucharist, the greatest gift that the Church possesses. The Blessed Virgin Mary will forever be with all of her children. She promises to us the same thing that she promised to Conchita in that last apparition. We will help you. I will be with you always and with all of my children."
Buenas tardes, hermanos y hermanas. Estamos aquí en San Sebastián de Garabandal, en la región de Cantabria, en el norte de España, para presentarles a todos un lugar muy importante para Nuestra Señora, porque en el año 1961, la Virgen del Carmen de Garabandal apareció para cuatro videntes, hasta el año 1965. También aquí hubo apariciones importantes del Arcángel Miguel. Vamos a conocer un poco aquí del pueblo de Garabandal, y después vamos a subir al lugar de las apariciones en lo alto de una colina. Acompáñenos en esta oferta de oración, de devoción y en esta pequeña peregrinación que hoy compartimos con todos. Llegamos aquí a la iglesia de San Sebastián de Garabandal, la única iglesia del pueblo, donde también fue testigo de los acontecimientos de las apariciones de la Virgen del Carmen de Garabandal. Este lugar es un lugar, como sabemos, de devoción, de fe y de unión con Cristo a través de la celebración eucarística. Ahora vamos a continuar por dentro del pueblo, camino al lugar de los pinos, en lo alto de una colina donde acontecieron los eventos de Garabandal. Hermanos, llegamos aquí al lugar donde comenzaron las apariciones en Garabandal. Estamos ya subiendo la colina en donde los acontecimientos se dieron en el año 1961. Y en este momento, aquí verán que estamos en el lugar donde el 18 de junio de 1961, un día domingo, el arcángel Miguel se apareció a las cuatro niñas. Y a partir de allí se comenzaron a desencadenar los acontecimientos en Garabandal, con la llegada posterior de la Virgen del Carmen de Garabandal. Aquí llegamos a otro punto de la colina, de la subida a los pinos, en el lugar de las apariciones. Aquí el 30 de junio, el Sagrado Corazón de Jesús apareció para una de las videntes, para Jacinta. Ella decía que Jesús no le dio un mensaje, pero sí le reveló la expresión del amor de su corazón a través de una manifestación de rayos blancos y dorados que salían del corazón de Jesús. Y esa aparición a Jacinta le dio la sensación y la confirmación de que Cristo siempre estaría con ella en su caminar, en su vida. Fue una revelación bastante importante que ella recibió, un momento de comunión interna con el Sagrado Corazón de Jesús. A partir de ahora vamos a seguir caminando y vamos a conocer el primer lugar donde fue la aparición de la Virgen del Carmen de Garabandal. Subiendo ahora a la colina de Garabandal, comenzó a caer una lluvia, gracias para todos nosotros, para todos ustedes, y llegamos a este sagrado lugar donde apareció aquí la Virgen del Carmen de Garabandal el 2 de julio de 1961. Queremos contarles que el 1 de julio, un día antes, el arcángel Miguel anunció a las niñas sobre esa aparición de Nuestra Señora. A partir de allí, con la aparición de la Virgen de Garabandal, los acontecimientos en este lugar comenzaron a ser más profundos y más fuertes para todos los pobladores y para todos los que participaban y asistían a esos acontecimientos. Ahora vamos a continuar subiendo cuesta arriba esta colina hasta llegar al lugar de los pinos, donde se dieron muchas más apariciones de Nuestra Señora. Llegamos aquí, a lo alto de la colina, en los pinos de Garabandal, donde entre 1961 a 1965, Nuestra Señora, como la Virgen de Garabandal, se presentó aquí para dar mensajes y revelaciones importantes para todos. Vamos a llevar en nuestro corazón este momento, esta peregrinación interna que hemos compartido juntos, para ofrecer a Nuestra Señora en este día las oraciones y las canciones que serán elevadas a los cielos para que sus gracias y sus misericordias puedan descender una vez más en la humanidad. Vamos a sentir en nuestro corazón este impulso que nos trae el mensaje Garabandal y que en la bendición de Nuestra Señora del Carmen todos tengamos un buen trabajo. Gracias a todos.
This is the village of Garabandal, Spain. A small pueblo of less than 100 homes, population under 500, in the heart of the Cantabrian Mountains, where a series of great phenomena took place beginning on June 18, 1961. This is a quiet village where, for the most part, the people engage in conversation about their cattle, pasture land, and weather. The children play simple games, and as all children will, they too get into mischief from time to time. On Sunday, June 18th, 1961, Mary Loli Mazón, Jacinta González, and Conchita Gonzales, all age 12, and Mary Cruz Gonzales, age 11, slipped away from the square, the center of all town activity, and, at the suggestion of Conchita, ventured a daring escapade. They traveled along the sunken lane toward an apple tree near the schoolmaster's house with a plan to steal apples. It was on this Sunday afternoon that these four very average young children experienced what was later to be realized as the first of many apparitions. All of these apparitions were preceded by three signal calls that only the children could feel rather than hear. The first apparition on June 18, 1961 took place in this sunken lane. This cross marks the spot where the lady and the angel appeared. This is the pine grove where many of the apparitions took place and where the promised miracle will occur. The children on many occasions received communion from the angel at the pines. The host was always invisible. Many skeptics asked for proof that all was not a fraud. When Conchita asked the lady for proof, she was told by the lady that a visible host would appear on July 18, 1962 and was instructed to announce this 15 days prior to the event. This is the home of Conchita in Garabandal. Her mother walks toward the spot where the miracle of the visible host took place. On July 18, 1962, before a large crowd, Conchita received communion and the host became visible for all to see. This photo of the event was taken at night with only a flashlight for illumination. Today, this simple wooden cross acts as a marker to remind the world of the great place here. This is Conchita Gonzales with her mother and two brothers near their home in Garabandal today. As you can see, she is no longer a 12-year-old child. Conchita is a nurse who is dedicating her life to helping others and spreading the message of Garabandal, as she had been charged to do by the lady over 10 years ago. The following message was the first the children received on October 18, 1961. We must make many sacrifices, perform much penance, and visit the Blessed Sacrament frequently. But first, we must lead good lives. If we do not, a great chastisement will befall us. The cup is already filling up, and if we do not change, a great chastisement will come upon us. Recently, Conchita Gonzales was in New York City working with Dr. Dominguez, specialist in internal medicine. We were privileged to meet and interview Conchita at that time. We now translate and share that interview with you. Talking with Conchita is Dr. Dominguez.
Do you remember as a little girl ever playing games which involved the lady?
No, never. We never played games like that.
Well, why do you think the lady chose you?
I just don't know.
Conchita, is your life different now than it was before the apparition?
I think it's very different.
Mm-hmm.
However, before we were little girls, and now we're grown up. I can't say what part of my life has been different than it would have been without the apparitions. I believe they've changed all of my life.
Well, do you think that if you never had these apparitions, that you'd be living the same life as you lead now?
No, definitely not.
Well, Conchita, have you ever denied the apparitions?
Yes, I had doubts in 1967 that were very real. In the morning, I was all right, believing in all the apparitions, everything. All of a sudden, I started to feel some doubts and was doubting for about 3 days, all except the signal calls. I went to the bishop and told him my doubts.
Mm-hmm.
And he told me that since I felt this way, I should not talk about the apparitions. After that, when people asked me about the apparitions, I told them I didn't like to talk about them. Sometimes I wanted very much to talk about the lady. But then since I had these doubts, I preferred not to. Then again, I thought if I did not talk, the lady would think I was a traitor to her. But I was afraid if I spoke about the apparitions, I might be doing something bad to the people because of my preceding doubts. So you see, I had all of these problems within me.
Conchita, this is Pelham Bay. Do you like to swim?
I don't know how, but I would like very much to learn.
White Stone Bridge.
And over there, that's the White Stone Bridge. It connects New York City and Queens.
Oh, that's the bridge we take when we go to Long Island.
That's right. Yeah, that's the one.
City Island, New York.
Now here, this is where we fish. Well, is this like the river in Garabandal?
No. This is the sea, and in Garabandal, there's only a small river.
Oh, yeah. Right. You know, I'd like to talk to you about the events in your little village of Garabandal in 1961.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you remember what happened there on the 18th of June, and what you were doing at that time?
Oh, I remember it very well. I'll never forget that in my life. I was walking and playing with the other girls, and then about 7 p.m., I went with my three friends to take apples. After taking them, we went to the lane to eat them,
mm-hmm.
And then suddenly we heard a big noise. Then a figure appeared. It was a child of 9 years old, but it was a figure of an angel, and that's what happened.
Well, what were you doing in that lane?
In the lane, we were eating apples.
Describe the figure.
It was a childlike face with a blue dress with wings, mm-hmm. Pink wings.
Right.
Although he looked 9 years old, his body looked like a strong man.
Mm-hmm.
He never spoke to us then. He just stood there and appeared to us.
Well, did he come again? And then did he stay there? Or did he talk to you? Or didn't he talk to you?
In the beginning, he was there for 3 days without saying anything. But he had a sign at his feet that said, the 18th of October, 1961.
The 18th of October?
Yeah, yes. It was written in Roman letters, but we didn't understand the rest. One day, about the end of June, he told us that on the second day of July, we would see the lady.
The 2nd of July?
Yes, the lady came and explained the writing that we could not understand. She told us to tell the message to the people on October 18th, 1961.
Can you tell us what that message was?
We must make many sacrifices, perform much penance, and visit the Blessed Sacrament frequently. First, we must lead good lives. If we do not, a great chastisement will befall us. The cup is already filling up, and if we do not change, a very great chastisement will come upon us.
And now, can you tell us if this message was it addressed to anyone in particular?
The lady said the message was to be given to the whole world, not to anyone in particular. No certain religion or group of people, but to everybody, for we were all her children.
So not just for people there in Spain or here in America or Russia?
No, for everybody, everywhere.
Well, do you remember what the lady, do you remember what she looked like?
She was more like a young girl of 18 or so.
Mm-hmm.
Very beautiful. She came with a little boy at times. We thought it was the baby Jesus. She wore a white dress and a blue tunic. Her hair was long and brown. He told us the message, then started to talk to us like a mother with such great patience and love. She spoke to us about several people in particular before she left, saying that she would be back the next day.
Do you remember your reaction when you first saw her? Or were you afraid?
No, no. She was like a mother. It was as if I'd known her well and just came home from a trip. It was a sensation of joy, of pleasure, expecting to see her again. She was just like a mother, a good friend.
So then you never had fear when you were with her?
No, never. No.
Now, when you were with her, I read you were not aware of the, well, the people around you.
No, from the moment that the lady came, it was as if we were out of Earth. We didn't realize anything around us. We didn't even feel the weather.
Well, some books say that they pricked you with needles. Now, do you remember that?
No, we didn't feel anything when they stuck us with the needles. But afterwards, we noticed that we had some punctures in the skin, you know. Mm-hmm. But as it was happening, we felt nothing.
Nothing at all.
Y recuerdo también haber leído que muchas veces caíais de rodillas, fuerte así.
I also read that sometimes you crashed very hard to your knees on the rocks. Now, do you ever get hurt when you crash like this?
No, no. We never realized we were falling down hard. We were never aware of what we were doing.
Never any pain at all?
No.
Now, about the message the lady gave you on October 18th, did you ever inquire about any particular part of it?
Well, the lady explained about the sacrifices, and she said that the sacrifices are to be remembered every moment of the day, as we are always in the presence of God. So we have to do little things like not smoking a cigarette when we really want one, so that we are reminded that we're living for the good of God. Simple things like not looking at something we like very much or not wearing something we like. We do this for God and remember the whole day that we're doing this for God.
Well, what about sacrifices? Do you ever make a special sacrifice?
Yes, doctor. We wore tight knotted belts. We were trying to do things so that the lady would notice that we were sacrificing. She noticed and smiled, telling us that this was not the penance she meant, never to harm ourselves, but to accept what God gives us in everyday life.
So it's just small things in everyday life?
Yes.
Now, about the part of the message that said we must lead good lives, can you tell us what the lady said to you on that?
The lady told us that when you want to know how to live a good life, you should get into yourself. Think in God and try to listen to God because He will tell you what you have to do. So just listen to God.
Is this the way you should lead a good life?
Everybody can hear God if he listens. The explanation was not for us in particular, for no one in particular, but for everybody in the world.
In other words, she...
Other than personal messages, all others were for everybody.
Now, about the warning, can you tell us what and when the warning will be?
I don't remember the date.
Well, do you remember the year?
I believe it was in 1964.
Yes.
Well,
this warning seems to preoccupy me. I'd like very much to know all I can about it, what it will consist of, and where will it occur.
The lady said that she was going to give us the best remedies to help us live good lives. And this warning was for the whole world. It will be felt all over. Garabandal, America, the whole world.
Will we all know it as a warning?
Yes, everyone will see it. Feel it. You will feel alone in the world before your sins and all your miseries and have a chance to amend your life. It will be a terrible feeling. You'll suffer terror, but without physical pain.
Will I feel the warning in the house?
Yes.
Or in the street?
Yes.
Whether in Russia or Africa?
Yes, that's right.
In other words, all over the world?
That's right.
Whether Protestant, Catholic, or Jewish?
Yes, everyone will feel it. Everybody in a different way. It will be felt in all countries by people of all religions.
Will anyone die from the warning?
No, only if it is by shock.
No, in other words, there will be no physical pain or damage.
No.
Now, there is another thing I would like to ask you about the apparitions. That is about the great promised miracle. Can you tell us what she said and when she said it?
I don't remember the date exactly.
Well, do you remember the year?
It was about 1963, 64. She said there would be a great miracle in Garabandal that God will perform for the world.
The miracle will be performed in Garabandal, but it will...
everybody in the world. It will be something very big, and there will not be any doubt that God has sent it himself. He will use nothing of this world to make this miracle. All present near and around will witness it. The sick will be cured.
What about the very sick?
She did not specify. She said the sick will be cured. For example, God says that Joey Lamagino will regain his sight, and the first thing he will see will be the miracle, and he will remain cured.
Now, I know Joey Lamangino from here in America. He's totally blind. Did she name him by name?
Yes, Joey Lamangino. And it was on the 19th of March, 1963.
What else extraordinary will happen at the time of the miracle?
There will be a sign that will remain for all time in the pines that you can see, photograph or televise, but not touch. A definite sign from God.
People of other than your religion, such as Jews, Arabs, Protestants, will they see the miracle?
Oh, yes. The lady said all present.
No exceptions.
It's for everybody in the world.
All present at Garabandal will see it?
All will see it.
Will sick people of other religions be cured too?
Yes. The lady said the sick will be cured.
Now, there is another question I would like to ask you concerning the warning and the miracle. Now, do you know the date they will happen?
That's the question everybody asks me. I don't know when the warning will come, but it will be before the miracle. The date of the miracle I know exactly. However, I've been charged by the lady not to speak of it until 8 days prior to the miracle.
So you will tell the world 8 days before the miracle?
Yes. I will tell everybody 8 days before it happens.
Well, this information about the warning and the miracle is impressive. However, I'm sure the messages are the most important. Can you now give us the final message?
Yes, it was June 18th, 1965. The angel came and gave me this message. As my message of October 18th, 1961 has not been complied with and has not been made known to the world, I'm advising you that this is the last one. Before the cup was filling up, now it is flowing over. Many cardinals, many bishops, and many priests are on the road to perdition and are taking many souls with them. Less and less importance is being given to the Eucharist. You should turn the wrath of God away from yourselves by your efforts. If you ask his forgiveness with sincere hearts, he will pardon you. I, your mother, through the intercession of Saint Michael the Archangel, ask you to amend your lives. You are now receiving the last warnings. I love you very much and do not want your condemnation. Pray to us with sincerity and we will grant your request. You should make more sacrifices. Think about the passion of Jesus. The lady told us to pray the rosary. She also said she likes the proudest, the least, and that to be humble is the best thing.
Did she ever say anything to you about obedience?
She taught us how to pray the rosary every day with her and how to be obedient. For instance, she never let us come to the church when the bishop prohibited us from it, because sometimes the people in their excitement became uncontrollable and caused accidental damage to themselves and to the church.
So she taught you to obey the bishop?
Yes. She told us, for example, to obey the bishop and the church before her.
Well, this whole story is very, very impressive. How do you think I can fulfill the message? And what must I do?
Every person knows what he has to do. Just listen to God and your conscience. Everybody knows when he does good or he does bad. So follow your conscience. Do what God says.
So you think the main part of the message is to lead good lives, as was God's plan for us?
Yes.
So now, Conchita, tell us what you're doing in accordance with what the lady told you.
I'm doing nothing special.
Well, you are a nurse, no?
Yes, doctor.
Are you fulfilling the message this way?
I try to take every advantage on any occasion to fulfill the message in little or big things. For example, if I get hurt or a little injury, I offer it to God as a penance. Then I try, to the best of my ability, to help everybody around me by setting an example with my life, with words, and in any way I can be spreading the word of the lady.
After all that has happened in Garabandal, what are you doing now?
I'm waiting for the words of the lady to be fulfilled. I'm waiting for the miracle.
When we see the Blessed Mother, she has so much light. We don't see nothing around us. We don't feel where we are. Then all the time we look up to her.
And she spoke to you?
Yeah, she spoke to us. To me, I feel when I see her, it's like one friend you see for so long. She talked us right away. She said, "Hi, Conchita." And she said,
"Hi, Conchita?"
Yeah, in Spanish, you know, "Hola, Conchita." And she talked to all the girls, and then we talk about everything happened to us, and from the time we see the angels, we tell her everything we do in the family, you know, like...
Were you frightened?
No, I tell you, it's like we see one girlfriend and we don't see for so long. It's very, I say, it's like my mother. I don't see for so long, I feel like I know her before. The The Blessed Mother gave us the message the July 4th, and she said to us, give it you October. But the first message is, I don't say in Spanish, but I can say in English. Hay que hacer muchos sacrificios, mucha penitencia, visitar al Santísimo con frecuencia, pero antes tenemos que ser muy buenos. Ya se está llenando la copa, y si no cambiamos, tendrá un castigo muy grande. This is the first message. Can be all over in the world, you can be any place, you can be, you know, in the aeroplanes. So you can feel that aviso. Can be direct from God. No man can do it on any explanation, human way, you can explain how, you know, the aviso. And you can feel inside you, and you can see with your eyes. But they don't go hurt you.
It's not going to hurt you.
No. Like it, to me, it's like two stars, what you call crash.
Yes.
Like two stars in the scratch, they make a lot of noise, a lot of light, but they don't fall down. You know, the thing, they don't hurt us, but we're going to see it. In that moment, we're going to see our conscience. You're going to see what everything wrong you see, you do it.
You're going to see everything wrong that you're doing.
And you're going to see everything good you don't do it.
Everything good that you're not doing.
Yeah. The miracle Qigong sent to us, the purpose is to leave us know the message she tells us is what she wants to be done. And she wants to save us. And she thinks when we see the miracle, then we're going to change our lives.
So it's to tell people that the message is true?
Yes, all the messages.
What can you tell us about the big miracle?
Well, the only thing I can tell gonna be in my village, the miracle. Cause something gonna happen in my village.
In Garabandal?
Yes, everybody's there around the village can see it. The people sick gonna be there, gonna be cured. The Blessed Mother say los enfermos sanarán. And the sickness gonna be converted. And then after that day gonna be one sign in the pines. It's gonna be like
there's going to be a sign where?
In the pines.
In the pine trees.
Yes, in the pine trees. We see the Blessed Mother in the pine trees a lot of times. And she said, going to be one sign there. And she tell us the sign going to be, it's going to be there forever. Like, for example, this dome going to be there, but like it, like maybe the rayo del sol. Something we can see is only from God, going to be there forever.
Do you know what sort of sign?
I know the sign, but I don't know, I can explain. I know you can see it, you can take pictures. But you can touch, you can't palpar.
Feel it?
You can feel it.
So it's like a bright light?
Yes, something like that. And it won't be there forever.
That sign will stay there?
Yeah, forever.
And this big miracle, do you know when it's going to happen?
Yes, I know the year won't be happening, I know the day, but the Blessed Mother said tell 8 days before. Then I talked to my vision. I remember still my vision, a lot of hours explaining the whole thing. Yeah, I told the vision, I don't see the Blessed Mother. Inside it's like one dream, I don't know what happened. The only thing, I don't know who tell me the message. I don't invent the message. I tell him, I feel las llamadas. I can't explain that. It's a miracle, somebody tell me the miracle. And he said to me, don't worry. You know, you only you confess me. I confess to him, and he give me the solution.
Absolution.
Yeah. And then after that, the bishop said to me, it's better you don't talk no more about the Apparitions.
Did you go on doubting, or did you start believing again?
Then I remember when the people come into my village and they asked me about the Apparitions. And I say I don't believe, I feel like I talk against to the Blessed Mother. I don't feel right inside.
You don't feel right?
And I tell the people this whole story, I feel shame. I start fooling these people. I don't know what, for this I had to leave the village. I can't stay there no more.
You had to leave the village because of all the people wanting to talk to you?
Yeah, I don't know what to say to the people.
You didn't know what to say to them?
Yeah, I say everything is true, I feel like foolish then. Yeah, I say it's not true, I think I heard the Blessed Mother.
So you thought that you were fooling them if
yeah.
You said it was true,
yeah.
But that you were offending
the Blessed
Virgin
Mother,
Mary.
Yeah, I say it's not true.
If you said it's not true, so yeah, you left the village?
Yeah, then I left the village. But, you know, to come into America, I come into America to work. I don't tell nobody I come here. I am all alone in this country for a lot of months and nobody know about. Where I work in, nobody know who I am.
So you came here anonymously?
Yes.
And
then I start, you know, remember a lot of things. Then I forget the Blessed Mother's picture, you know, when I see her. You know, I start remember the Blessed Mother again. And I start, you know, remember her voice. I start remember the angel. And then I can explain how I start the apparition.
You couldn't explain the apparition?
I can't explain that. I know I see the Blessed Mother, I see her. You know, I talk to her, I see the angel.
So you went back to believing that it was true?
Yes, I see her.
And how many months was it that you...
A lot, you know, more than 1 year.
More than 1 year?
Oh, yeah, I live it like that.
For more than 1 year, you thought that your apparitions were a dream?
Yes. Well, I can't explain it.
You couldn't explain it?
You know.
But what do you think now?
Now, I see the Blessed Mother, I see the angel, I hear her voice, I wait for the miracle.
So now you believe that your visions were true?
Yeah, but I'm going to tell you something. If the miracle don't come in, I don't think there's nothing true then.
If the miracle doesn't come,
yeah,
you'll think there's nothing true?
Yes, but the Blessed Mother, every time she says something, has happened.
So you know the date for the miracle?
Yeah.
8 days before it?
I don't tell to everybody.
You'll tell everybody?
Yes.
If the miracle doesn't come...
I hope that this won't happen. Now I'm coming.
But today,
yeah,
you believe it will come?
Yes, I believe very strongly it's coming. No, I never, I think, tell.
And you believe that your visions of the Virgin Mary were true?
I believe I see the Blessed Mother, and I believe I see the angel. Then, the Pope is coming and say, no, you don't see the Blessed Mother, this is not the Blessed Mother. Then I say, you know, I see the lady, beautiful lady. I see a beautiful angel, look like an angel.
You know, don't you, that many people have delusions. They imagine,
yes,
that they see things.
Yeah.
Do you sometimes worry that maybe you have had a delusion?
I don't worry about that. Before I worry when that doubt. But then we had the doctor, they do all kind of... They're studying in us. You know,
they studied you?
Yeah. They say we are normal.
They say you're normal?
Yeah.
Did you think maybe you were sick in the head?
They say we are sick in the head. Then they say they are sick, but I am sick. But, you know, but blessing sick, I am be sick like that. I like to be sick like that in that time.
You'd like to be sick if you see visions like that?
Sure.
When you look at your little children and you look ahead to the future, are you frightened for them?
Yes, I do. Even a lot of time I say, I got to take my children to heaven. I won't miss them, but I like miss them. Take the comes. I think they're going to suffer.
They're going to suffer?
Yes.
Why?
But I believe after the miracle, all this saying we're going to change our lives. But we had, I think we lost a lot of, like, the same or the same. We lost like a lot of the same of the sing no more, you know, like we don't to spoil, we don't do sacrifice.
You mean we've lost a sense of sin?
Yes.
Yes.
It's very hard to, you know, to start all over again and then to teach to children. Like I see the way they teach to children now, it's no sin no more.
No sin?
Yeah. Like I believe we're going to get the punishment.
You do think the punishment's,
yes,
going to come?
Yeah, if the punishment coming, I am sure going to, you know, get my children.
It's going to get your
in
children?
In my children's life.
In your children's lifetime?
Yeah.
And that worries you?
Sure, it worries me. Yeah.
Can you help them to be saved from the punishment?
The only thing I can do is the best thing we can do is, you know, teaching the babies the best to love God, the Blessed Mother, have strong faith in Jesus.
And what now do you want for the rest of your life?
Love God. I do his will.
In the summer of 1961, mysterious events took place on a high mountain in northern Spain. Four young girls between the ages of 11 and 12 were taken up into ecstatic raptures. During these raptures, they experienced visions of great future events and received messages from the Virgin Mary and Saint Michael the Archangel. Between 1961 and 1965, they experienced over 2,000 of these apparitions. While enraptured, the girls exhibited unexplainable physical characteristics. They did not feel pain when needles were pushed into their skin or when they were touched by lighted matches. They were unaware of the spectators around them. When not in ecstasy, the girls continued to live their normal lives as peasant farmers and shepherdesses. Great events were foretold during these ecstasies, events that yet remain to happen. Now, almost half a century after the apparitions, the world awaits the first of the four prophesized events. It is called aviso in Spanish. In English, it is known as the warning. At various times, the girls described this supernatural event that would be seen and felt by everyone in the world. Three of the visionaries have given testimony about the warning over the years.
During 1972 and 1973, Conchita made two interviews about Garabandal. From these interviews, excerpts are here presented to show what she said about this warning.
About the warning. Well, this warning seems to preoccupy me. I'd like very much to know all I can about it, what it will consist of, and where will it occur.
The lady said that she was going to give us the best remedies to help us live good lives. And this warning was for the whole world. It will be felt all over. Garabandal, America, the whole world.
Will we all know it as a warning?
Yes, everyone will see it, feel it. You will feel alone in the world before your sins and all your miseries and have a chance to amend your life. It will be a terrible feeling. You'll suffer terror, but without physical pain.
Will I feel the warning in the house?
Yes.
Or in the street?
Yes.
Whether in Russia or Africa?
Yes, that's right.
In other words, all over the world?
That's right.
Whether Protestant, Catholic, or Jewish?
Yes, everyone will feel it. Everybody in a different way. It will be felt in all countries by people of all religions.
Will anyone die from the warning?
No, only if it is by shock.
No. In other words, there will be no physical pain or damage.
No.
There is something else that interests me, and that is the warning that will occur before the miracle. Here is an unusual picture. Sometimes when you mention the warning, you would say that it was like a starburst.
That was an example.
What will occur on the day of the warning?
The most important thing about the warning is that every person, everyone in the whole world will see a sign, a grace, or a punishment within themselves, in other words, a warning. They will find themselves all alone in the world, no matter where they are at the time, alone with their conscience right before God. They will then see all their sins and what their sins have caused.
Let me see if I understand this correctly. One of these days I'm going to feel the warning. No matter where I am, I'm going to feel it.
Any place you are.
If I am in the house or in the street, or if I am in Russia or in Puerto Rico or Santo Domingo or Spain or Cuba, no matter where I am, I will feel this warning.
You will feel it.
Who will feel this warning? Catholics, Protestants, Communists, Jews?
Everyone that lives in the world.
Will we all feel it at the same time?
Yes, at the same time.
So everyone will feel it at the same hour? How long will it last?
I don't know how long it will last. However, everyone is going to feel it differently.
Will it last a half hour? Will it last an hour?
I really don't know. I think that 5 minutes would be an adequate time.
How will we feel it?
We will all feel it differently because it will depend on our conscience. The warning will be very personal. Therefore, we will all react differently to it.
This is amazing. One day I will be alone in the world with nothing around me except God and my sins?
Yes.
Will something happen to me because of my sins? I mean, will physical harm come upon me as a result of my sins?
No, unless it's something that results from the shock, for example, a heart attack.
Nothing like fire or pain?
No.
No physical harm then, so it'll consist of facing God alone with my sins. How about the good things? Will I see them also?
No. This will be only a warning to see what you have done with your sins. It will be like a purification before the miracle to see if with this warning and the miracle we will be converted.
This will happen before the miracle.
Yes, before the miracle.
So this can occur any day now.
Yes, but I don't know the date when it will occur.
It's supposed to be a warning. What is the purpose of this warning?
It's a purification, I know, because it's supposed to be you notice your the faults, your own faults, and how much we've been offending God. And the things that we do wrong, and to feel sorry for them.
Mm-hmm. Will everyone feel this warning at the same time?
Everybody's supposed to feel it, doesn't matter where they are in the whole world.
Mm-hmm. Even little children?
Yes, everybody, they will feel it in their own, the difference will be, the children, they will feel it as a children's, because they're feeling, there will be a lot like inside how they see the things.
And how will they feel it? Will it be something that you can see, or will it just be an interior feeling?
There will be an interior feeling, but I don't know if you not remember too good if anything that will be in the exterior too, because I remember something they say like they will everything stop. Uh-huh. It will be like for a moment, everything will stop, everybody will notice how much we offended God. You will see the inside the oneself, the things that we do wrong.
Everything will stop?
They will stop, that, but I don't know exactly. I just remember this word, it's like everything will stop.
You mean like even planes in the air?
No, I know asked that question like that. If it, because I not thought about it in that time.
What will people feel at that moment? Will they see their sins?
Yes, so each one they will feel, depending how the person is, they will feel frightened, they will feel very sad, because they recognize the things, they can see the things that they do wrong, very clear.
Mm-hmm. Will it be painful? Could people possibly die from this?
I don't know. I really don't know if that will happen.
But would it be like a painful thing for a person?
Yes. I think it would mean. They have to be a painful thing because if we see what we doing wrong and how much we're offending God very clearly, we feel it in ourselves, inside of us. Mm-hmm. I think will be very painful.
You once said that before the warning, communism would dominate the world. Did the Blessed Mother tell you this?
Yes.
And what do you mean when you say dominate the world?
Well, I don't know exactly the words it was, they would take over or the world.
The communists would take over the world.
The world.
And it would be every place, as far as you know.
Or? As far as I know, that's what I thought, but at that time my knowledge was not too far of the world. But
the impression that you got was that it was, as a child, what you saw then, you thought it was everywhere.
Yes.
And what will happen during this tribulation? Will there be a persecution?
Well, they say, she said that it will be very hard for the priests to say Mass, for the people to practice the religion. Uh-huh. And the priests, if they find out that they are priests, they will be persecuted.
And you also said that the churches would have to be closed, is that right?
Yeah, they will be closed because they will not allow the people to go to to the priest, to the mass, or to the people to go there.
And you don't know how long this tribulation will last?
No.
Will the warning, what will stop it? Will the warning stop it?
I don't know. I don't know how much later after that the warning happened.
The main visionary, Conchita, has made declarations about the warning.
The warning is a thing that comes directly from God and will be visible throughout the entire world in whatever place anyone might be. The warning will be like a revelation of our sins. It will be seen and experienced equally by believers and non-believers and people of any religion whatsoever. The warning is like a purification for the miracle. It is a sort of catastrophe. It will make us think of the dead. That is, we would prefer to be dead rather than to experience the warning. The warning is something supernatural and will not be explained by science. It will be seen and felt. The warning will be a correction of the conscience of the world. For those who do not know Christ, they will believe it is a warning from God. The most important thing about that day is that everyone in the whole world will see a sign, a grace, or a punishment within themselves, in other words, a warning. They will find themselves all alone in the world, no matter where they are at the time, alone with their conscience, right before God. They will then see all their sins and what their sins have caused. We will all feel it differently because it will depend on our conscience. The warning will be very personal, therefore we will all react differently to it. The most important thing will be to recognize our own sins and the bad consequences of them. Your experience of the warning will be different from mine because your sins are different from mine. This will be a warning to see what you have done with your sins. It will be like a purification before the miracle to see if with the warning and miracle we will be converted. The Virgin told me that before the miracle, God will be sending us a warning so as to purify us or prepare us to see the miracle. And in this way, we may draw enough grace to change our lives toward God. It is the phenomenon which will be seen and felt in all the world and everywhere. This phenomenon will not cause physical damage, but it will horrify us because at that very moment we will see our souls and the harm we have done. It will be as though we were in agony, but we will not die by its effects, but perhaps we will die of fright or shock to see ourselves. No one will have doubts of it being from God and of its not being human. I, who know what it is, am very much afraid of that day. The Virgin told us that the warning and miracle will be the last warnings or public manifestations that God will give us. This is why I believe that after them, we will be near the end of time. To me, it's like two stars that crash and make a lot of noise and a lot of light, but they don't fall down. It's something that's not going to hurt us, but we're going to see it. In that moment, we're going to see our conscience. You're going to see everything wrong that you're doing and the good you're not doing.
The visionary Loli has stated,
everyone will experience it, wherever they may be, regardless of their condition or knowledge of God. It will be an interior, personal experience. It will look as if the world has come to a standstill. However, no one will be aware of that, as they will be totally absorbed in their own experience. It is going to be something like an interior feeling of sorrow and pain for having offended God. God will help us to see clearly the harm we are causing Him and all the evil things we do. He will help us to sense this interior pain because often when we do something wrong, we just ask the Lord's forgiveness with our lips. But now, through the warning, He will help us sense physically that deep sorrow.
The visionary Jacinta has stated,
the warning is something that is first seen in the air everywhere in the world and immediately is transmitted into the interior of our souls. It will last for a very little time, but it will seem a very long time because of its effect within us. It will be for the good of our souls in order to see in ourselves, our conscience, the good and the bad that we've done.
Okay, we're here in Oxnard, California. Today, it's April 16th, 1983, for an interview with Jacinta Moynihan. Jeff, her husband, is going to be kind enough to be our translator. So we will begin the questions. Now, the first question is, for us. Jacinta, can you still remember what the Blessed Virgin looked like?
Jacinta, ¿puedes recordar cómo fue la Virgen en su aspecto?
Sí.
¿Cómo? Yes, she says yes, she can remember.
Sí, pues, ¿cómo, okay. Con el vestido, ¿cómo venía vestida en aspecto?
Pues su cara, por ejemplo, ¿cómo fue? ¿Guapa?
Oh, ¿no? Sí.
Pues sí, eso, fue guapa.
Oh, sí, la recuerdo como, pues, como una persona que jamás se puede olvidar.
Uh-huh. Yeah, she remembers her as somebody that you can never forget. Very beautiful, very beautiful person.
Here is a picture of Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Didn't you once say that the pictures of the Virgin that you saw, of all the pictures of the Virgin that you saw, this one reminded you the most of her?
¿Recuerdas que esta Virgen fue un poco parecida o no?
No.
No, she didn't remember that she looked this way as this picture.
Well, see, we remember that when Jacinta visited us in New York, Joey had a big painting of Our Lady of Perpetual Help, this particular painting, and people remember Jacinta saying that was the look that...
Well, the look on the face, like the expression.
Or maybe the expression in the eyes.
A lo mejor recuerda un poco en los ojos, porque es como los ojos como bondad, pero la cara es muy gorda esta.
She says that she remembers it real well because the eyes, says this eyes of this Virgin here, has a very compassionate look, you know, very kind. That reminds her of the kindness in the eyes of the Blessed Virgin, but says that the face of this Blessed Virgin is a little bit fatter than the one that the way she saw her. So in that sense, physically, the face is not that similar, but the eyes are similar in their look, you know, that way there's a similarity.
What about this one?
¿Y esto es
mejor? No, peor eso.
Peor? So that one's worse. But, you know, I mean worse in the sense that it's
not
in resemblance.
Not as close,
right? Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, very good. Can you describe the crown that Our Lady wore at Garabandal and the crown that the infant wore? And did you ever count the number of stars on the Virgin's crown?
¿Puedes decir algo sobre la corona de estrellas de la Virgen? ¿Cómo fue la corona?
¿De estrellas? De estrellas, venía así. De 12 estrellas.
She says that the crown was round, like she motioned, of 12 stars.
It was 12?
12. ¿Fue 12?
Sí, 12.
You counted
¿Has contado? 12?
Sí, por eso cada vez que veo una Virgen, lo primero que hago es contar las estrellas.
Yeah, she said the other count, and there were 12, and she says that's why, remember, she sees this type of a statue of the Blessed Virgin with a crown on, she counts and you see if there's 12, because that's the way it should be.
This is a fine detail, I don't know, were they six-pointed stars or five-pointed stars?
¿Recuerdas cuántos puntos tuvo cada estrella? ¿Fue como de cinco puntos or seis? Or?
Yo creo que cinco.
She believes that there are five.
Cinco.
You know, she believes that there are five-pointed stars.
Now, wasn't it true that the crown was open? It wasn't a complete closed circle, but was it open and come out from the temples like this?
Fue abierto, ¿no?
Sí, porque a veces nos las poníamos nosotros.
Yes, he said yes, it was open. And he said that sometimes they were able to put it on themselves, that the Blessed Virgin allowed them to put it on themselves.
But did it go straight up, or was it like this way, sort of out like on an oblique? Do you know what I mean?
No fue completamente arriba, they told them, no, fue un poco
enfrente.
Yeah, she said it was a little bit in the front, coming out a little bit. It wasn't straight up over, it was sort of slanted forward a little bit.
I see.
Very
good. Now, there was a pattern or design on the Virgin's dress. Can you describe what the design was like?
En el vestido de la Virgen fue un dibujo. ¿Puedes decir cómo fue el vestido?
Pues sí, era blanco con dibujos como flores, pero no se notaba mucho el dibujo. Nada más había como un dibujo, pero no muy marcado.
She said that the dress was white and that it had like flowers on it. And that the design, this pattern of flowers was there, but it wasn't real strong, you know, but it was sort of faint. And the pattern, but it was of flowers on a white dress.
Were they big flowers or small
grandes,
flowers?
Flowers, grandes or pequeños?
No, ni pequeños ni grandes.
They were neither real large or real small, sort of an intermediate size.
Okay. Can you... the Virgin wore no belt, is that right?
No cinturón, no.
No,
she didn't have
Can you describe the light that surrounded Our Lady?
Uh-huh. Were there rays of light, or was it just very bright? Mm-hmm. And were there any hues of color?
Mm-hmm. ¿Cómo fue la luz en los alrededores de la Virgen? ¿Fue como rayos, or cómo fue? ¿Eso, colores, or?
No sé, era muy brillante, era una luz muy brillante que no molestaba, pero yo no me fijaba en los colores de la luna, nada más miraba a la Virgen, nada más veía que había mucha luz.
She noted that there was a lot of light, so it was very bright, but she didn't notice if there were colors in it or not, because she was putting her attention into the appearance of the Blessed Virgin herself, but she didn't notice there was a bright light around her and behind her, you know.
Nada más veía cuando, por ejemplo, era de noche, todo era de día.
Yeah, so especially at night, if there was apparition at night, she noticed everything was so bright, it was like day. Mm-hmm. Day during night, you know, mm-hmm. so that was one thing she noticed very much, mm-hmm. you know.
But she didn't see rays of light, she just
saw light. No, rayos de luz.
No sé si eran rayos, solamente era una claridad muy grande, con una luz muy grande. Uh-huh.
She doesn't recall especially rays of light, but she just knew it was a great brilliance.
Yo no recuerdo porque no me fijaba en...
But she didn't notice in such small details, you know, like trying to analyze in the background.
But could she see anything in the background? Like, could she see on the fringe of this vision? Could she see the trees, say, by the pines, or anything like that?
Pues ver algo más, por ejemplo, en atrás de la Virgen, como los árboles,
no, otra cosa.
Nada más que luz.
Nada más luz en todas partes, luz. Ella redondada, nada más la Virgen y luz.
So no, all she could see was the Blessed Virgin herself and light. Everywhere she looked, it was just bright light mm-hmm. and Blessed Virgin. So it was only the Blessed Virgin and light, nothing else. Mm-hmm. Anything from the outside was not seen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The Virgin came to Garabandal as Our Lady of Mount Carmel and had the scapular on her wrist during the apparitions. Do you know what it was? Did you know what it was when you first saw it?
Mm-hmm. Cuando la Virgen apareció con el escapulario en su mano, ¿sabías que es escapulario la primera vez?
Pues sí, porque yo sabía que era escapulario porque siempre, como dije,
¿qué? ¿Porque tuvo el aspecto de un escapulario?
Sí, tuvo el aspecto de un escapulario. Además, no, nosotros en casa de mis padres toda la vida rezábamos el escapulario.
Yes, she said when the Blessed Virgin first appeared with a scapular, she realized the first time that it was a scapular because it looked somewhat like a scapular. And they had already been familiar with the scapular in their own family life because they'd always worn it and had it in their family life before. So she realized that that was the scapular when they, mm-hmm. she had it, you know, there.
Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Did Our Lady ever speak to you about it? Did she ever explain mm-hmm. the significance of mm-hmm. the scapular?
La Virgen habló del escapulario, dijo algo, por ejemplo.
Oh, sí, dijo que era muy importante para llevar el escapulario.
Yes, she said that was very, the Blessed Virgin said it was very important to wear the scapular. Was important, so she didn't explain that much. That was
she, in other words, she did more than she said something about it. She did more than just wear it.
She made a comment saying it was important to wear. That's
very
what
good.
She was saying. Yeah.
Can you describe the scapula the Virgin wore uh-huh. had on her wrist?
Uh-huh.
Y como un monte.
En
una parte y no sé, una cruz, creo.
Uh-huh. So there was like a mountain on it, and one part had like a cross on it. Mm. ¿Y fue algo más?
Yo no, es que no me fijaba yo en esas cosas.
Uh-huh. She said that she didn't really
yo
notice
sé que era
all the detail.
Pero no investigaba mucho no, a ver she, lo que she, era.
She didn't investigate real thoroughly. She knew it was a scapular, though.
But could you tell what color the cross was?
Uh-huh. Colors, los colores, la cruz tuvo un color o algo.
Yo creo que la cruz era blanca y el escapulario marrón, la tela marrón.
So it seems to me that the scapular itself was of a brown color, like a dark brown, mm-hmm. and that the cross was white. The cruz fue como blanca, like
sí.
a white cross. It seems to her that way, you know, that it was that color.
Can she remember what color the mountain was?
The mountain, la montaña, el monte, tuvo color?
Algo color tenía, a lo mejor sería como crema.
She said it had some sort of color, a little bit different to it, like a cream color. A cream color would be like a light brown. Mm. It was a different color because to be distinct.
Now, isn't it true that Our Lady did not wear the scapular when she carried the infant Jesus? Mm. But how did she hold him? Did she hold him then with both hands?
Mm-hmm. Es verdad que la Virgen no tuvo escapulario con el niño Jesús.
Cuando venía el niño Jesús, no.
Yeah, she says that when she came with the Christ child, she did not have a scapular with her. Does his father have to turn that on? That records awesome for the movie.
When Jacinta was describing Our Lady's crown, I had also asked if she could describe the infant's crown.
The infant's crown. Y el niño Jesús tuvo corona también.
No recuerdo.
So I don't remember if he had a crown or not.
No recuerdo.
No recuerdas?
No.
¿Hubo un corona pequeña?
No recuerdo.
Pero recuerdas al niño Jesús.
Al niño Jesús sí que lo recuerdo, pero no recuerdo la corona.
She says she remembers the Christ child, but she doesn't remember exactly if he had a crown on. That detail. No. So, but she remembers it.
Igual no la traía, no
sé. So it's possible that he wasn't wearing one, I don't know. She was saying she didn't remember that detail, but she doesn't remember him. She remembers him though.
How did the Blessed Mother hold the infant Jesus when she didn't have?
Oh yeah. ¿Cómo llevó la Virgen en su brazo el niño Jesús? ¿En su brazo, hermano, o cómo?
Pues así lo traía.
¿En un brazo, dos brazos, o cómo?
No, yo lo tenía en un brazo y el otro así. No lo traía con los dos, no lo traía con uno solo así.
It seemed like, so it seems to be the best way to have this child in one arm. Because it's small, because it's a baby, baby Jesus.
Nosotros lo cogíamos con las dos.
Says she and the other girls held it with two hands, in both arms, they'd be more careful, but, with the Resurrection, it was just like one arm because it was a baby, baby Jesus.
But she didn't have the scapular, but what would she be doing with her other, like if she had the infant like this?
¿Y qué pasaba con el otro brazo si no tuvo escapulario allí con el niño Jesús?
Es que yo no recuerdo eso, si lo tenía con las dos. Son detalles que no me fijaba en esto.
She says that those are details that she didn't really pay that much attention to. Mm. For example, when the Christ child was there, her attention was in him. It wasn't what the other arm had. Es posible entonces tú lo has capturado en otro
lado. No lo sé. Si sería ahora me fijaría más. Pero 12 años yo no me.
She's saying maybe it is possible that the scapular was in her other hand at the time, but she didn't notice it. So she was saying before that she wasn't. She didn't think it was, but it was that she didn't notice it there. But it's like she says now, it could have been there because her attention was looking at the Christ child at the time. Mm-hmm. But those are details that maybe at that moment had she been asked, after so many years, certain details can't recall everything.
Right.
Which is now.
During the apparitions, you were seen presenting a missal to the Virgin to kiss. Did she only kiss the cover or did she kiss the some of the pages?
Mm-hmm. La Virgen besó ese misal o cubierto encima o hojas también.
Tampoco lo recuerdo, yo no sé si se lo daba o lo abría por el centro.
Pero besó, ¿no?
Le besó, sí, pero yo no sé si era por la cubierta o lo abría por el centro.
So she remembers Blessed Virgin kissed the misal, but she's not quite sure whether, it was the pages inside too or just the cover. She doesn't remember it, but she does remember the fact that she did kiss the misal.
Okay. Now the next series of questions deal with the warning and the two nights of the screams. On the two nights of screams, you saw visions of the future conditional chastisement that will come to mankind if we do not change after the warning and miracle. Did you also see the warning?
Estas dos noches de gritos fueron apariciones del futuro del castigo y cosas, y también se vio algo del castigo del viso también.
Pero yo de eso no prefiero no hablar.
It was about that subject, she says she prefers not to speak about it.
Okay.
Porque nada más lo único en eso era lo que nos decía era que teníamos que pedir mucho y rezar mucho para el mundo.
She remembers
that. Pero ya no nos mando decir, pues decir lo que estoy viendo.
Yeah, she said that. So what she remembers was that the Blessed Virgin said it's very important to pray about that whole, affair that is to come. But she said that the Blessed Virgin didn't order them or tell them that they should publish or speak about all the details of what they saw, for the future there concerning the chastisement and the warning. So she says she prefers not to speak about it because she wasn't told to speak about it, and therefore feels that perhaps, she shouldn't. Reveal some of these details about the future.
But although there have been things that for example, I know Mary Loli has spoken about what she saw in that during the chastisement. But my question was, though, did they actually see the warning? I'm not asking if it's something that she can't speak about, but the question is, did she actually see it or
hear about it from the Virgin? Pues su pregunta es que no es hablar de los detalles, pero esta cosa de aprender del aviso fue cosa oído de la Virgen que va a venir un aviso o una cosa que estaba visto, que, como de aparición, visión.
Pues fue todo, porque yo creo que en ese momento todo se quedó como oscuro. Y pues, no puedo explicar eso.
So she can't explain it very well.
Yo no sé que pasé mucho miedo.
So she remembers she was very afraid at the moment, very terrifying, and she remembers that. As she said previously, that it seemed like it was everything, like both seeing it and then also being told about it by the Blessed Virgin too at the same time. Uh-huh. And then she remembers also everything got very dark.
Tiene que ser una cosa horrible porque teníamos mucho miedo, aunque sin ver a la Virgen, no sé, es una cosa.
So she can imagine that it's a very horrible thing because, you know, the fact that they were so terrified in what they were seeing. Mm. And at the same time, seeing the Blessed Virgin, you know, which is sort of taking away some of the fear that, you know, was something very terrifying. You know.
What about the communist tribulation? Mm-hmm. Did they see that? Did they see that in vision also?
Por ejemplo, esta cosa de los la tribulación de los comunistas, el comunismo, sí. Or Leos, ¿han visto algo o han oído de la Virgen algo de eso? ¿Cómo fue eso, la cosa de que va a tener revolución o todas esas cosas? ¿Qué es eso?
Pues no sé.
¿Puedes decir algo? ¿Fue cosa visto o oído? ¿Qué fue? ¿Que va a venir revolución o qué?
Pues fueron las dos cosas, pero no se puede explicarlo. No sé.
She said it was the two things, meaning that they were told about it and
pero
also
eso,
saw
pero,
something.
Pero nos dijo que había que pedir mucho para que esas cosas no ocurrieran.
She said the Blessed Virgin said the important thing is to pray a lot in order that these things don't come, you know, but it seems that, you know, it has something to do with prayer. People, you know, pray enough and it could be avoided, but I guess if there's not enough prayer, then these things will come, you know.
But could they tell the difference? Could Jacinta tell the difference between the chastisement and, say, the warning or this tribulation? Could they distinguish the difference between the two, since they saw both?
Uh-huh. Pero por lo menos puedes ver la diferencia entre el castigo y el aviso, ¿no?
Es que yo más que la... Pues el castigo es que es mucho peor que el aviso.
Uh-huh.
Porque el castigo es ya cuando ya no hay más remedio y el aviso es como un aviso como que te va a avisar para que no venga el castigo.
Uh-huh. It says, distinto. Yeah, she can see the difference. It says that, of course, the chastisement is much more serious things, tremendously much more serious, because that's when there's no choice in the matter, the last resort, you know, when it finally comes, the chastisement, of course, is a serious thing, a punishment, whereas a warning is simply just a warning, you know, that, you know, it's much less, you know, it's not as serious a thing as the chastisement, it's a warning, so they could distinguish between the two, you know, experiences that they were, you know.
Mm-hmm. In a 1979 interview, you said that during the communist tribulation, quote, it was like an invasion, unquote.
Uh-huh.
Did you see scenes of this invasion?
In una entrevista antes, has dicho que has visto algo como, no, una cosa como una invasión, que has visto como una invasión, que fue, una invasión, revolución, que fue esa cosa, que has dicho que has visto una invasión.
¿Que yo que he visto?
Sí, como invasión. ¿Qué prefiero? ¿Invasión? Ok.
Pues yo es que a veces confundo la invasión con la persecución.
So sometimes she confuses the invasion with the persecution. He gets the two confused sometimes. Two separate things. So, persecución y invasión, ¿no?
La persecución es cuando una persona quiere, pues cuando está luchando pero nunca llega a triunfar, ¿no? Entonces es como una lucha, pero la invención es cuando una persona ya triunfó.
Claro, no, la invasión es cuando un ejército, soldados entran en un país, como y la gente va como corriendo, escapando de un ejército que viene. Esa es invasión. La persecución es cuando, por ejemplo, un grupo como comunistas hacen mal a la iglesia, cierran iglesias y ponen todo edificio. Pues como, el aspecto fue como fue, como revolución o como.
Pues era, no es toda una mezcla, no sé.
Does it seem like a mixture and all? Because I asked her, I said, you know, the invasion, an invasion is like when, you know, soldiers come in from another country and people are running, trying to escape, you know, the invasion force coming in. That's a type of tribulation or turmoil, civil turmoil, running away. I mean, that's invasion. And persecution is, you know, when things are made difficult, like for the church. Like, mm-hmm. for example, if the communists take over in certain countries, closing down churches, and so.
Did she? Would she rather talk about certain things than other things?
The Blessed Virgin, you mean, with
yeah,
the girls?
Yeah.
Would she prefer certain subjects to speak about than others? La Virgen preferiría unos asuntos de hablar en vez de otros asuntos. Hay temas que ella prefería hablar.
El tema siempre lo más que ella era, siempre casi eran los sacerdotes.
Says the subject matter that the Blessed Virgin seemed to prefer more than others was the subject of priest, you know, of the priesthood and priests themselves. This was a subject that the Blessed Virgin seemed to favor most over other subjects, about the priesthood and priests in general.
Very, very significant.
Mm-hmm.
Did the Blessed in the first message, Our Lady asks for penance and sacrifice. What does penance and sacrifice mean to you? How do you interpret that?
Mm-hmm. La Virgen habló en el primer mensaje pidiendo sacrificio, penitencias. A ti, ¿qué significan las palabras sacrificio, penitencia?
Ah, pues sacrificio para mí significa aceptar las cosas que no te gustan o, no sé, todas las cosas, hay muchos sacrificios.
Says for her the word sacrifice means accepting the difficult things. You know, the things that one doesn't like to have to accept, but still accepting them against, you know, the liking, the personal liking of the person.
Did the Virgin ever indicate to her what would be a sacrifice or a penance?
La Virgen ha indicado que será un sacrificio, por ejemplo. Ella dio un ejemplo diciendo que esas cosas un sacrificio, una penitencia.
Ah, pues en decir un sacrificio de penitencia, no, ella nada más, o sea, que sea, teníamos que ser sencillas, humildes y que teníamos que ser honestas. Entonces yo no sabía lo que era eso.
Uh-huh.
Y obedientes.
Son cosas que ella dijo
que debíamos de ser así.
Uh-huh. Well, the Blessed Virgin, when she said the way they should act or be, may not specifically be to the word sacrifice, but she said that it should always be simple, honest, you know, ¿qué más? Sencillos, obedient, very important, obedient. And all this was related to sacrifice, in a sense, like a sacrifice to have to be those ways, you know. But sometimes it is a sacrifice to have those virtues, you know.
During the apparitions, the Virgin taught you to recite the rosary very slowly. Do you think she did this only because you were children who should learn to say it properly? Or do you think it was an example that everyone should follow?
La Virgen enseñó el rosario, decirlo muy despacio. ¿Dio esto como un ejemplo para todos o solamente para los niños?
No, era para todos, para que decía que había que pensar lo que se decía para meditarlo mejor.
Yes, no, she's
para todos.
Said it was for everyone. The Blessed Virgin did it as an example for everybody, not just because they were children learning to do it better, but as an example for everyone in order to meditate better on the rosary. By reciting it slowly, they can meditate better, you know, instead of doing it fast.
Okay. When you recited the Hail Mary in ecstasy, bystanders heard you use the phrase, Mother of God and Our Mother in the Hail Mary. Did the Virgin ever say anything to you about using this phrase or innovation?
Uh-huh. La Virgen, cuando ustedes han dicho esta cosa, nuestra madre, madre de Dios, sí, nuestra madre. La Virgen dijo algo sobre esto, si está bien.
Que, ella dijo que le gustaba, pero que hasta que no lo aprobaría la iglesia, que ya no decía nada.
The Blessed Virgin answered, she said she liked it, she liked their, the way they said it, but on the other hand, that they should not say it until the church approved of it. Uh-huh. And since the church hadn't approved of it, they actually shouldn't say it, although the Blessed Virgin did like it, you know, personally.
Well, how did you come to say it? Did you decide beforehand, among the four of you, that you would say it that way? Or did it just come out spontaneously while you were praying in ecstasy?
Y cómo salió esto de decirse de la Virgen Nuestra Madre? ¿Cómo salió de repente?
De repente, porque estábamos diciendo Santa María, Madre de Dios, pues era Madre de Dios y en ese momento la sentíamos Madre Nuestra.
So it just came out suddenly from them, they didn't plan it ahead of time. Uh-huh. That as they were saying the Hail Mary, they just felt it inside of them, come on them, and they just came out of them, you know, as they were praying.
Como era una madre, pues nosotros queríamos decir, pues eres también madre nuestra.
They wanted to tell her, you know, you're our mother too, you know.
But did all four say it at the same time?
Las cuatro, ha dicho eso, salió de repente, las cuatro.
Yo creo que salió de repente así, no sé, no sé cómo fue.
She doesn't exactly sure exactly how it happened, but she says it seems to her that it just came out, with all four of them all at once, like that, you know. Mm-hmm. Just something.
Very interesting. Okay, I think you've already answered this question. Did the Blessed Mother say not to use that form until it was approved by the church?
So not to until it was approved.
Okay, when was the last time you went to Garabandal?
¿Cuándo fue la última vez?
Ya va a ser tres años.
3 years ago.
What do you think of the village today as compared to what it was during the time of the apparitions?
¿Y cómo qué piensas del pueblo comparado hoy día? Como de antes, durante el tiempo de apariciones.
Pues me gustaba mucho antes porque era más sencillo, pero pues...
¿Te gustó más antes?
Más antes sí, porque era más sencillo y como más espiritual también.
So she liked it better before the way it was because it was more, the people were simpler and more spiritual, you know. Mm-hmm. And now it doesn't seem to be quite as simple, you know, it's not as spiritual. It's más como del mundo.
Sí, pero si todo me gusta.
Well, she says, you know, she says now it's more worldly, but on the other hand, she still likes it because it's her hometown, you know.
The visionaries to see a vision of the Sacred Heart at Garabandal. When you reflect on that vision, what comes to your mind first?
Tú fuiste la única para ver a Sagrado Corazón. ¿Qué piensas cuando recuerdas eso?
Pues pienso, lo admito, me hace más, ¿cómo se dice? Cada vez una cosa, más sensación, lo tengo como más grabado que la Virgen.
Uh-huh. Y, well, she says that she remembers this better than the apparition of the Blessed Virgin herself, that this made a bigger impression of seeing the Sacred Heart, and that, you know, it's of course a more important thing to her. Mm-hmm. ¿Y qué piensas de él?
Pues no pienso porque no me dijo nada, nada más me miró como una cosa como diciendo, ay, como estoy contigo, estaré contigo, no sé.
So,
como una mirada de amores, no sé.
So he had like a look of love on his face, and therefore, you know, she had a feeling that, although he didn't say anything personally to her, her feeling was, I am with you, and I will be with you, you know. Mm-hmm. And so when she thinks of it, she has this same feeling that, you know, I will be with you, you know, I am with you. And so that's the way, the type of feeling or thought that she has, you know.
Fue muy distinto a la Virgen.
So it was very different, though, than the apparition for the Blessed Virgin, in that sense, you know.
Okay. What thoughts come to your mind first?
Y cuando, ¿recuerdas las apariciones de la Virgen en San Miguel? ¿Qué pensamiento? ¿Piensas de la Virgen y las apariciones de la Virgen en San Miguel? ¿Qué piensas?
¿Cómo que piensas?
¿Qué es el primer sentimiento o pensamiento?
El primer pensamiento es eso. Yo pienso que por qué me escogió a mí.
So her first thought, when she recalls this apparition, she said, why did they choose me, you know, instead of somebody else for this, you know? That's her first thought, feeling. Why me? Okay.
Are you aware that something is supposed to happen that will cause most people to stop believing in Garabandal? Do you know what that is? What that
something
is?
Sales que va a pasar una cosa que la gente que cree en Garabandal va a dejarlo, no va a creer más. ¿Sabes de esa cosa
no.
Or no sabes nada de eso?
No, no sé nada de
eso. She doesn't know anything about that particular point. You know?
Okay.
You know, reunite. ¿Y dijo cuándo?
No, no, pero no dijo que pidiéramos.
She didn't say exactly when. They said the prayer
did she say, did she indicate if that meant the Protestants and the Catholics, or did that include, like, the Orthodox and the Catholic?
No, dijo que iglesias, por ejemplo, iglesias protestantes, or ortodoxas, or otras religiones, or...
Todas que se unirían a la católica.
She said all would reunite into the Catholic Church. All the other churches.
Now that's important. She said all would come into the Catholic Church.
Yes, come into it. Reunite. Todos van a entrar dentro de la
Iglesia. Sí, ella nomás decía a la Iglesia Católica, no nombraba las otras.
She said into the Catholic Church. She didn't name specifically the names of the other churches, but she said all the churches would come into the Catholic Church. Todos van a entrar dentro de la Iglesia Católica.
Dentro de la Iglesia Católica. Pues nada más, ella nos hablaba de la Iglesia Católica, no nos hablaba de las otras iglesias.
Sí, pero dijo las otras iglesias van a entrar a la Iglesia Católica, ¿no? Que dijo que hay otras iglesias, ¿no?
No dijo nada, ella no ponía nada de otras iglesias, decía la humanidad, solamente va a haber una iglesia.
Ajá.
Pero no
hay la humanidad.
Sí,
y solo la Iglesia Católica.
Sí, pero no decía de esto, okay. Porque ella nunca criticaba a nadie.
Sí, okay, fine. The way it was worded, the best word said, it says all humanity would be within one church, the Catholic Church. That's the way it was worded. All humanity. You know, she didn't name any other church. She didn't criticize anybody. She didn't say anything. She just said all humanity would be, you know, within one church, Catholic Church. This is similar to the prophecies of some of the saints, too.
So did she say within one church or within the Catholic Church?
Oh, within the Catholic Church, she said. It would be just one church only, and would be the Catholic Church.
And it would be the Catholic Church?
Yes, the Catholic Church.
And the Blessed Mother definitely used that word, Catholico.
Dijo la Iglesia Católica.
Católica, sí.
Yeah, she said the word Catholic Church and all mankind. Toda la humanidad, all mankind, would be...
Pero que había que pedir mucho.
No, but she said also it's necessary also to pray towards this intention too, but she said it would happen. It would take time. Will happen.
Did she say, indicate when?
No ha dicho cuándo, no.
No, nada más. En nosotros está. Pues si pedimos más, pues más rápido.
Más rápido. It says we should pray towards it, but by praying more prayer can mean it happen quicker. You know, not as much prayer happened later, but it would happen.
Mm-hmm.
They're saints, it's importante.
Sí, muy importante.
The best
como lo quieren quitar.
So the best version,
importante.
The Blessed Virgin said confession is very important. The question says the Blessed Virgin speak about sacrament of reconciliation. Confession. So he said yes, it's very important. Instead of saying now that there are people who want to do away with it, you know, just get rid of it. But it is a very important sacrament.
Does the Virgin ever indicate how often people should go to them?
La Virgen ha dicho, ¿deben ir a menudo or cuánto? Or no dijo cuántas veces deben ir a la confesión?
Pues eso depende. Pero dijo que era muy importante porque es pues reconocer que has pecado y entonces te da un sacramento para ponerte más fuerte.
Best version, as far as you remember, didn't indicate exactly how often they should go, but they said it was very important that it should go when necessary, and that it's important to recognize within oneself that they had sinned in order to make an effort not to do so, to improve oneself, recognize.
Jacinta has mentioned once before that she had a dream where she saw people taking communion in the hand.
Yes.
Was this dream... Was it something that she thought was bad? Did she have the understanding that this was a good thing, a bad thing, or just something that was going to happen within the church?
Cuando tú dices ese sueño, ¿qué pensaste de la comunión en la mano? ¿Qué va a pasar? ¿Eso es cosa buena, cosa mala?
Cosa mala yo pensé. Como que no se daba respeto a la Sagrada Comunión.
Cosa mala. When she had this dream, she felt it was it seemed kind of bad to her at the time because it seemed like you weren't giving as much respect to the Holy Communion.
Mm-hmm.
And she had mentioned before it was at the beginning of the apparitions.
Como miedo me dio, no
yeah,
sé,
it kind of scared her. She said she had this dream at the beginning of the apparitions in summer of 1961, you know, before any of this was discussed. And it was like a prophetic dream, a prophecy, because she saw people there receiving communion in the hand as if it were approved of already by the church, you know, and people doing it. and but she didn't like it because to her it was less respect for the Blessed Sacrament. So to her it seemed like something that wasn't good.
But then when you went up to communion in this dream, you they wanted to give you communion in your hand.
You know, swaying no two faces of your part of your communicating in dark communion.
Sí, no la quise.
Yeah, in a dream she dreamed that they wanted to give her communion in the hand, but she didn't want it in the hand. She didn't take it.
En ese momento desperté.
And then she woke up at that moment, but she refused to take it in the hand. And she woke up at the moment. Sí. But the interesting thing is the dream happened in the summer of 1961 at a time when there was no discussion yet about having communion in the hand, and she had never heard of it. Mm. And she had told her mother the dream and told several other people, and they said, oh, this seems a very bad dream, a great scandal. How could they say that the church would approve of communion in the hand, giving it out to everyone in the hand, and less respect? But it came true. Mm-hmm. Like many other things she has dreamed has come true afterwards, like, you know. Well, no, I think it's a very important.
Some of the dreams that Jacinta has had.
Yes. Well, yeah, it's really surprising, you know. There's been some dreams that they're like prophecies of things that are going to happen. And I remember the day my father died, that morning Jacinta told me that she had a dream that my father was going to die suddenly, and he had never had anything wrong with himself. And later that day, it was on a Sunday, he went to Mass and Communion, and a few hours later he was at home, he had had a heart attack and died suddenly that same day. So it was the same day that Jacinta told me that in the dream she saw my father was going to die suddenly. And it happened that later that same day, and we didn't tell anybody about it. Mm-hmm. And it was such a shock and surprise because my father was only 60 years old. And he was still, you know, working. He was very active, and he had no health problems that we knew of. Mm-hmm. And so it was like a warning to prepare us in a way. It was like an act of mercy from God to show what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. And there have been other activities and things that Jacinta has seen, like for the future. And they've happened, you know. Usually, they pertain to family members or to friends, and certain things that were normally kept hidden. Then Jacinta would see them and say, "Well, this is going to happen," and she saw it in a dream. And then later, a few months later, the events would turn out exactly as she had described, as if she had seen them, you know. Mm-hmm. And it seems like a gift from God, and it's something that is very beautiful. It shows that God shows concern in our own personal lives. And it's sort of like a preparation for things that happen, and a little bit of a message too. And it's like a grace from God, so I think it's worth mentioning, you know, that these things happen too, which are very nice. But of course God, I think, gives everybody something, you know. If they don't receive one thing, they'll receive something else from God. So he's very generous in giving, you know, gifts and talents and so forth, and he has something for everyone, you know.
How many brothers and sisters do you have?
¿Cuántos hermanos?
Ocho.
There's eight children altogether.
How old would they be now?
¿Cuántos años tienen? ¿Son mayores? Or?
Sí, porque yo soy la séptima.
She's number seventh, you know, the second to the last, so they're all older, except for one. They're all older than her.
And what are they doing now?
¿Qué hacen?
Todos están en España, menos uno que está en Nueva York.
She's around Spain working, except there's one in New York that works there in New York. So,
do you like living here in California?
¿Te gusta vivir aquí en California? ¿La vida? Es un sacrificio, ¿no?
No, o sea, no sé.
Sí, la verdad, es un sacrificio.
Me gustaría más vivir en España, sí. Pero... pues tengo que estar aquí.
She says she would prefer to live in Spain, but she has to be here. So it's something of a sacrifice. It's not really a luxury, you know. Mm-hmm. Although California is a nice place, it's probably a sacrifice to be far from home. It's a sacrifice from one's home country, one's menudo hablar por teléfono aquí.
Sí, pues a lo mejor una vez al mes, pero una vez estoy casi dos horas.
She says sometimes she calls as often as once a month because they're on the phone together, and sometimes they talk as long as 2 hours. When she feels sad or a little bit depressed, and talk to her friends, she calls.
How is Jacinta?